Good evening, everyone. I would like to welcome all my viewers for another live session on Tadvidya Sambhashya Parishad. Today in this lecture, we will discuss about the remaining conditions of, that is, practical aspects regarding Yoni Vyapat. The first condition is Shushka Yoni Vyapat. Acharya Charaka has explained Shushka Yoni Vyapad under Vataja Yoni Vyapad. So as its name or terminology suggests, Shushka Yoni Vyapad, it is a condition characterized by dryness in the vaginal orifice or dryness in the whole, sometimes dryness in the whole vagina is also present. The Nidana and Samprapti of Shushka Yoni Vyapad goes like this. Vyavaya Kale Rundyantya Vegan Prakupito Anilaha Kuriyat Vinmutra Sangarti Shosham Yoni Mukasticha. Vyavaya Kale Rundantya. Rundantya means Vegadharana, that is suppression of natural urges. So the main cause for Shushka Yoni Vyapad is suppression of natural urges during coital act, that is during Vyavaya Kala, and suppression of natural urges during menstruations. So both these causes leads to Vata Vruddhi, aggravation of the Vata Dosha, and it leads to Dhatu Rupi Artava Kshaya. As I mentioned earlier, in earlier classes, Artava can be considered as one is Dhatu Rupi Artava and Rajo Rupi Artava. Rajorupi Artava refers to menstrual blood and Dhaturupi Artava refers to ovarian hormones, that is estrogen and progesterone. So here, due to Vata Vruddhi, there will be Dhaturupi Artava Kshaya, that means it is considered taken as estrogen deficiency. So due to Nidana Sevan, it leads to Vata Vruddhi and it then leads to Dhaturupi Artava Kshaya, that is estrogen deficiency, and then further it results into Shushkata in the Yoni Pradesha, that is dryness in the vaginal orifice or the whole entire vaginal region. So coming to Lakshanas, so they have mentioned some other Lakshana, that is Vinmutra Sangarti, that is Vitsanga and Mutra Sanga, that is retention of urine, and sometimes it leads to retention of the stools, and also it is associated with Arti, that is vaginal pain, and finally it leads to Shosham Yoni Mukasticha, that is Shushkata in the Yoni Mukha. So as we all know, vaginal flora, here Acharya Chakrapani, the commentator of Charaka Samhita, he has mentioned Yoni Shosham. Yoni Shosha means Yoni Dvare Drava Abhavam. Yoni Dvara Drava Abhavam. That means here the vagina is absence of moistening fluid. So vaginal flora is always maintains with some moistens or some lubrications. So this is due to estrogen hormone is responsible for this lubrication and moistening in the vagina. So whenever there will be a deficiency in this estrogen, and it leads to vaginal dryness or shushkata in the yoni pradesha. And also, as a complication, it will also leads to Nashtartava. Adhamalla explained this Shushka Yoni Vyapad in later stages, it leads to Nashtartava. Nashtartava means absence of menstruation. So if you see in modern terms also, always estrogen deficiency leads to hypomenorrhea, and gradually it leads to So as I was telling, Acharya Adamala as explains, it is leads to complications like Nashtartava, that is due to estrogen deficiency, it leads to hypomenorrhea, and gradually it will causes amenorrhea, that is absence of menstruation. So considering these symptoms, it can be correlated with vaginal dryness due to estrogen deficiency, and it is usually seen in premenopausal or menopausal women. As a physiological changes, it leads to estrogen deficiency, and because of that, vaginal dryness will present. And coming to Chikitsa part, Chikitsa in Shushka Yoni Vyapad means here Vataja symptoms will be more. That means there will be an involvement of more of Vata Dosha. So we have to give the treatment which specifies or which reduces the or which mitigates the Vata Dosha. And we have to give some Ushna and Snigdha therapy, Snigdha and Ushna Dravyas to mitigate the Vata Dosha. We can give oral drugs and also we can perform some sthanika chikitsa like Sneha Pichu with the help of Vatahara Taila, and also we can give Uttarabasti with Jeevaniya Siddha Taila or Jeevaniya Dravyas. And next, the next condition is Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat. Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat, this is according to Acharya, it is explained under Dvandvaja, that is, there is involvement of two dosha, that is Vata and Pitta. And according to Sushruta, it is explained under only Vataja Yoni Vyapat. So the both the Acharyas were having a different views among this among this condition, that is Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat. So, Pariplutha means it is a condition characterized by pain all over the pelvis. Pari refers to the word, the meaning of pari refers to sarvataha. Sarvataha, that means all over the region, that is all over pelvis, the pain will present. So that why it is considered as Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat. That means all over the pelvis means on the lower abdomen region and on the groin region and also backache. That means lower back pain bhi rehta hai. So it is considered as Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat. The Nidana of Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat are, Charaka explains, Pittalaya Nrusamvase Kshavatu Udghar Dharanat Pitta Samurchito Yonir Vayum Dushayati Striyaha. That is, Pittalaya Nrusamvase. Here Nr means Nru refers to Nara, that is man, and Samvasa means whenever a lady will contact with a man. Samvasa means having sexual contact with a man, and she does a suppression of natural urges, especially and particularly suppression of urges like Shavaton Udghara, that is suppression of sneezing and belching while doing intercourse, and it leads to aggravation of the Pitta Dosha. So whenever a Pitta Prakriti lady does suppression of natural urges during coital act, then it leads to aggravation of the Pitta Dosha, and this Pitta Dosha associated with Vata takes Sthanas and Shreya in the Yoni Pradesha, and it leads to Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat, and it shows following Lakshanas like Shunatva Sparsha Ahishnutva. That is, Shunatva means numbness in the vaginal region, and Sparsha Asahishnutva. Sparsha Asahishnutva refers to tenderness in the vaginal region. So usually when we does the bimanual examination, that is per vaginal examination, we can felt through the lateral fornices of the vagina. So in that lateral fornices, there will be tenderness will be present. So this is said to be a sparsha asahishnuta. Shunatvam, sparsha asahishnutvam. And also it leads to neela pita asrik sraved. Neela Pita Asruk Sravet, that means abnormal kind of vaginal discharges. As it involving both the Vata and Pitta Dosha involvement is there, so it leads to abnormal vaginal discharges, and also it leads to irregular menstrual bleeding. Neela Pita Asruk Sravet, that is irregular menstrual bleeding. And Saarthi means it is associated with the menstrual bleeding, the irregular menstrual bleeding is associated with pain. And it leads to Shroni Vangshna Prushtarthi, that means a backache, that is pain in lower back region and also pain in groin region and lower abdominal region. So that's why this condition is said to be a Pariplutha, that means pain all over the pelvic region. And it also leads to Shroni Prushtarthi Asruksravet and Jvarartayaha Pariplutaha. Jvara is one of the main symptoms in this, which has specially explained under Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat. As we are discussing, we had discussed this, most of the 10 univapats, 10 to 11 univapats in Vataja condition, but in none of those univapat has having the symptom of Jwara, because here in Pariplutha univapat there will be an involvement of Pitta dosha. Due to this Pitta dosha, always Pitta dosha leads to infection and inflammation in the body. So because of this infection and inflammation, so there will be, we can see the symptoms like Jwara, that is hyperpyrexia or increased temperature in the body. That means it shows some systematic symptoms in the body. So Jwara is one of the most important symptom in Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat, as it results into infection and inflammation. So considering these factors, this Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat can be correlated with chronic pelvic inflammatory diseases. So in the as same like Pariplutha Yoni Vyapat, all these symptoms will see in the condition of chronic pelvic inflammatory diseases, or generally we called as PID in clinics. PID, that is pelvic inflammatory disease, means infection and inflammation in the upper genital tract involving fallopian tubes, ovaries and some other surrounding structures like adnexia and any other ligaments and pelvic region, so and so. So infection and inflammation in the upper genital tract called as pelvic inflammatory diseases. And who are the high risk factors for this PID? Means one, the woman who is having multiple sexual partners, and one who is menstruating teenagers, and in also a woman having a history of acute PID, that is acute pelvic inflammatory diseases. That means if the lady has already suffered from acute PID, then the, some of the infection and infective conditions will remains inside the body. So that leads to punaravartaka. That means sometimes in after some time, that means after 6 months or 1 year, it can lead to chronic PID, that is who are having a history of acute PID and who have inserted intrauterine contraceptive devices like copper T. Because whoever has inserted this copper T, so jo monofilament thread jo hota hai copper T mein, this monofilament thread will act as a ladder for this ascending infection. So these peoples are said to be a high risk factors for PID. And next, the causative organisms which can spread PID are, sometimes it may be due to Mycobacterium tuberculi, and also due to Neisseria gonorrhoeae, that is which can cause gonorrhea infection. And sometimes it is causative factor may be Chlamydia trachomatis. So all these are some microorganisms which can transfer this kind of pelvic inflammatory diseases. And mode of spread or mode of transmission is by, maybe it is by ascending infection, and also it can also transformable through venous or lymphatic drainage. So these are mode of transmission of these causative organisms, microorganisms. And clinical features in this pelvic inflammatory diseases are, so we are talking about only a chronic pelvic inflammatory diseases. So here the symptoms and clinical features are bilateral lower abdominal pain. So that means on the both the sides of the abdomen there will be pain will be present, bilateral lower abdominal pain. And also symptoms like abnormal vaginal discharges and irregular menstrual bleeding. So as we so all these symptoms can be easily correlated with this Pariplutha condition, because in that condition also abnormal vaginal discharge like Neelapita Asrik Sravet has been present, and also irregular menstruation is there. And also moving further in modern concepts, as I said, lower abdominal pain, and also it leads to dyspareunia, that is difficulty in coital act. This is one of very important clinical symptom. So whenever a lady comes with a complaints of dyspareunia, that is difficulty during coital act, maybe it is a one of the we can suspect it is maybe because of PID or chronic PID. And also it leads to some systematic symptoms like fever, lassitude, that is lethargy, and headache, and also it leads to nausea and vomiting. So these are all some symptoms or clinical features in chronic PID. And if we examine the patient on while doing parabdominal examination, we can elicit lower abdominal tenderness in the lower abdomen region. And if we do per vaginal examination, that is digital examination, that is by inserting two fingers inside the vagina, after inserting finger in the vagina, we can palpate the lateral fornices. So there will be a tenderness in these lateral fornices. So whenever a woman is suffering from chronic PID, it is definitely this signs can be elicited by doing per vaginal examination. And also while doing per speculum examination, the cervix is congested cervix, and also some purulent discharge is coming out through the cervical region. So how we can diagnose this chronic PID condition. So moving to Sushruta's view, Acharya Sushruta's view, as I said, both the Acharyas has different view among about this Paripluta condition. So according to Charaka, so considering the clinical features which has been explained by Charaka, the Paripluta Yoni Vyapath can be correlated with chronic PID. But Sushruta tells some other views, that is Pariplutayam Bhavati Gramya Dharmena Ruja Brushum. That means he explains that Pariplata means Gramya Dharmena Ruja Brushum. That means Gramya Dharma refers to coital act or sexual intercourse. So it is a condition characterized by excessive external and internal pain during coital act. So this is the condition said to be Pariplata Yoni Vyapath. And the pain is due to involvement of the Vata Dosha. So as Sushruta explained under Vataja Yoni Vyapath, Paripluta under Vatala Yoni Vyapath. So there will be involvement of Vata Dosha will be there. And next, so considering as it is a direct symptom is there, so it can be directly correlated with dyspareunia, that is difficulty during coital act. Dyspareunia is a condition where difficulty in coital act or painful coital act will be there. So the causes behind this dyspareunia can be considered under, or can be explained under, or it depends on the site of the genital tract. That means one is superficial, and another one is vaginal, and another one is deep dyspareunia. So superficial causes may be, that means if any lesions in the outer, that is external genital organs, like in vulva, that is labia minora or labia majora, all those things. So the causes are due to any lesion in the lower part of the labia minora, and it is also due to Bartholin gland cyst, and maybe due to narrow introitus or tough hymen. That means nulliparous woman, vaginal introitus is small only, but it's not too laxity, not will be there. But in the cases of narrow vaginal introitus, that means if the vaginal orifice is too small, and in the cases of a tough hymen, the penetration, there will be a problem or pain during penetration will be there. So it leads to dyspareunia. And in vaginal causes means, in the condition of vaginitis, that is infection and inflammation in the vaginal region, and also due to vaginal septum, there may be a transverse or longitudinal vaginal septum, and also due to tender scar, that is tender perineal scar. That means if a woman has underwent any vaginal surgeries like perineurophy or colpotomy or episiotomy, so there will be a suturing will be there. So after sometimes the suture will be, the healing of suture will be present, but the scar, whatever the remained scar, it leads to tenderness. So because of that tenderness, there will be a pain during intercourse will be present. And next, deep rooted causes are here. Deep rooted causes can be cause pain deep in the vagina after penetration of the penis. So the causes may be due to endometriosis and retroverted uterus, and also it is due to chronic PID. So chronic PID is one of the cause for this perineia, and also due to chronic cervicitis. So these are the some causes for deep rooted dyspareunia. So and we have to treat the patient according to the symptoms, and especially according to the cause we have to treat the patient. So the treatment which has explained in Ayurveda about Paripluta Yoni Vyapadar, as it is Pittaja involvement will be more, so we have to give Pitta Nashaka Dravyas or Pittahara. We should adopt Pittahara Chikitsa. So both orally and as an external administration we can prescribe the drugs. So orally we can give Shatavari Gruta, as Shatavari is best in Vata Pittaja disorders, as it is well known for Vata Pittahara condition. So Shatavari Gruta is prescribed, and also we can give in Jivantyadi Gruta, and also Kshira prepared out of Madhuragana Dravyas, as all those Madhuragana Dravyas has having the qualities or can mitigate the Pitta Dosha. So we can prescribe Kshira prepared out of Madhura Aushadha Siddha Dravyas. And also according to the symptoms, so whenever if a lady complaining of severe backache or lower abdomen pain, so in that case we can prescribe Yogaraja Gugulu, Mahayogaraja Gugulu or Kaishora Gugulu. And if at all if we seen any infective condition, that means any purulent discharge, or if it is associated with any other urinary symptoms, so in that case we can prescribe Chandra Prabhavati kind yogas. And for external administration, we can administer Sneha Pichu, Taila Pichu prepared out of Panchavalkala Siddha Taila. As Panchavalkala acts as both Stambaka, and also it is very helpful in inflammatory conditions. So Panchavalkala Kalkadharana or Panchavalkala Siddha Taila Pichu can be administrated. And also Basti, which is prepared out of Madhura Yukta Dravyas Taila, we can prescribe, or we can advise Basti in the form of that. So all these are Chikitsa part of Pariplita Yoni Vyapat. Next, move on to another condition, that is Rakta Yoni. So Rakta Yoni also explained under Pittaja Yoni Vyapat. Acharya Charaka has explained Rakta Yoni under Pittaja Yoni Vyapat, and Acharya Vagbhata has also explained Rakta Yoni under Pittaja Yoni Vyapat. According to Acharya Vagbhata, Rakta Yoni means Rakta Yonyakhyam Srugatihi Sutehe. That means Rakta Yoni, it is a condition characterized by excessive vaginal bleeding. Rakta Yonyakhyam Srugatihi Sutehe, that means vaginal bleeding per vaginam excessive, and it is excessive in nature. And further Charaka has explained in detail, that means he has explained Rakta Pitta Karair Narya Raktam Pittena Dushitam. I repeat, Rakta Pitta Karair Narya Raktam Pittena Dushitam, that means whenever a lady consumes Pitta Kara Ahara and Vihara, and it leads to aggravation of the Pitta Dosha. So Pittakara Ahara Vihara, that means in the sense of if she eats more Ushnakara and Ushna Tikshna Kattu and Vidahi Yukta Aharas, and also if she eats more and more of Kulata and Dadi Matsya, so all those all these things or all these eatables which can lead to aggravation of the Pitta Dosha. And due to Pitta Dosha, whenever this Pitta Dosha involvement or aggravation will be there, it always increases the rakta pramana in the body, that means udirana of the rakta, and also it vitiates the rakta dhatu, because based on samanya vishesha siddhanta, that means samanyam vruddhi karanam rasa hetur visheshastu, as we all know this basic concept. So according to this concept, the whenever there will be a similar qualities in two dravyas, always it increases the another dravya. That means here rakta and pitta are having the same qualities or same guna, so whenever there will be a aggravation of pitta will be there, it leads to pitta rakta pramana, that means it increases the pramana of rakta, and also as it is a dushita pitta, it also vitiates the rakta dhatu. So in this condition rakta yoni, there will be a involvement of both pitta and rakta dosha. So rakta pitta karair narya raktam pittena dushitam ati pravartate yonyam labde garbhe api sasruja. So and this and main clinical feature or main symptom in this condition is ati pravartate yonyam, that means excessive vaginal bleeding or excessive bleeding per vaginam, and labde garbhe api sa asruja. Labde garbhe, here labda garbha refers to, that means the concepted, that is after conception, that means whenever a lady consumes or indulges in pittakara ahara vihara even after conception, and it leads to some kind of chemical abortion, or it leads to abortion because of implantation failure. जो क्या होता है, अगर if a lady conceives हो गया है, conception हो गया है, और उसके बाद if a lady consumes more and more of pittakara ahara vihara, the endometrium part will not or the endometrium will not be receptive, and it leads to implantation failure, and then it results in the abortion condition. So because of this rakta yoni, it leads to asruja, or Acharya Chakrapani explain it as apraja also, because as she remains as a vandya, that means the conception is not possible, and so this condition is said to be apraja also. So moving to chikitsa part, so here also as there will be a involvement of pitta on both, rakta dosha will be there, so we have to give rakta and pittahara chikitsa. And they have mentioned rakta yonya asrugvaranair anubandham samiksha cha, that means we have to give the treatment based on, first we have to assess the dosha involvement, and we have to assess the color and odor of the menstrual blood. So jo bhi excessive bleeding hota rehta hai, so we have to assess the color and odor of the menstrual blood, and then we assess the dosha involvement. So according to that we have to treat the patient. So rakta yonya asrugvaranair anubandham samiksha cha tatah kuryat yata dosham. So whatever the dosha involvement will be there, so according to that we have to administer the treatment. And rakta sthapanam aushadam, that means, and also we have to give some rakta sthapaka dravyas, that means in the there will be more vaginal bleeding will be there, so we have to give stambana chikitsa, so to stop the bleeding, and also we have to give some rakta sthapana dravyas, that means to increase the hemoglobin percentage in the body, we have to give, that means we have to correct the anemia in the patient. So some rasa yogas like chandrakala rasa or bola parpati or pradarantaka rasa, so all these drugs can be prescribed in this condition. And also classically they have mentioned uttarbasti prepared out of uttarbasti with gruta prepared out of kashmiri and kutaja, that is kashmiri and kutaja siddha gruta as uttarbasti we can give to the patient. And also uttarbasti with rakta of ajand avi pranis, so we have to take rakta of ajand avi, and we can give in the form of uttarbasti. So this is the treatment regarding rakta yoni vyapad. And this rakta yoni vyapad can be correlated with DUB, that is dysfunctional uterine bleeding. Dysfunctional uterine bleeding is a condition, or it is defined as a state of abnormal uterine bleeding without any clinically detectable organic pelvic pathology. So here DUB mein kya hota hai, abnormal uterine bleeding hota hai, but here the cause will not due to any detectable, clinically detectable pelvic pathology, organic pelvic pathology. So organic pelvic pathology, in the terms of it is not due to any tumors, or it is not due to fibroid, or it is not due to any polyps, or not due to any iatrogenic, like that means because of not inserting any copper tea. So jo kuch bhi organic pelvic pathology kuch bhi nahi rehta hai, fir bhi abnormally uterine bleeding hota rehta hai, because the main cause behind this is due to altered function of HPO axis, that means disturbance in the hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis, and it is absolutely endocrine in origin. So jo bhi bleeding ho raha hai in this condition, it is absolutely due to disturbances and or altered function of HPO axis, that is hypothalamo pituitary ovarian axis. And there are two kinds in DUB. One is ovular bleeding and second one is anovular bleeding. Ovular bleeding means whenever the condition or the menstrual cycle associated with ovulation, then it is said to be ovular bleeding. And anovular bleeding means if the menstruation or menstrual bleeding is not associated with ovulation, then it is said to be anovular bleeding. So this ovular bleeding is seen in 20% of the cases. Only in 20% of the cases we can see this ovular bleeding, and it is usually seen in reproductive age group, that means between 18 to 40 years of age group, this kind of ovular bleeding will be present. And it shows symptoms like a polymenorrhea and functional menorrhagia. Polymenorrhea means the interval between the two cycles are less than 21 days. As we all know, the normal regularity of the cycle, or the normal interval time between two cycles is approximately it is 28 days hona chahiye, and sometime it will be in the range of 25 to 35 days. So 25 to 32 days will consider it as normal range only. But if the cycle comes less than 21 days, so then that condition is said to be polymenorrhea. So that means here the frequency of menstruation is more in 1 year, so that condition is said to be polymenorrhea. So in ovular bleeding, polymenorrhea can occur, and also it can show as a functional menorrhagia. So functional menorrhagia means heavy and prolonged bleeding. That means here the regularity will be normal, that means the cycle will comes between 28 days or 30 days of cycle only, but the duration and amount of the bleeding is more. So duration is more, so the normal duration is 3 to 5 days, but here the duration is more, that means the menstrual bleeding can occur more than 8 days, more than 10 days tak, and also the amount is also more. So normally 30 to 80 ml of this is the normal volume of loss of menstrual blood during one cycle. So sometimes this amount will be more, and then that condition is said to be a menorrhagia. So in ovular bleeding, of TUB, it can show as a polymenorrhea, and it can also show as a functional menorrhagia. So both the condition are considered as DUB only. And next, the second condition is, and this ovular bleeding is due to, the pathology behind this ovular bleeding may be because of improper shedding of the endometrium, or maybe due to improper ripening or growth of the endometrium. So jo bhi menstrual blood jo nikal ke bahar aata hai, this is due to shedding of endometrium only. So uterine bleeding is due to shedding of endometrium. So whenever this endometrium will not growth properly, or if it is not sheds properly, then it leads to this kind of functional menorrhagia or polymenorrhea. And this all this improper shedding and improper ripening of endometrium, it's all due to insufficient production of or insufficient secretion of estrogen and progesterone hormones. So that's why I said it is completely a altered function and are disturbed in the HPO axis. And second one is anovular bleeding. So anovular bleeding can be seen in 80% of the cases, and it is usually seen in adolescent girl and in premenopausal women. So adolescent girls means whenever she starts the menarche, that is during the puberty time, that is from 13 to 16 years of age group, we can see this anovular bleeding, because in that time, that means between 13 to 16 years or 17 years of time, the ovulation has not yet established properly. So ovulation tabhi tak, tab tak 16-17 years tak clearly properly completely establishment nahi hua rahata. So that's why it leads to anovular bleeding. And in premenopausal stage, follicles are get atrophic. So the follicles are the number of follicles are less, and then it leads to anovular bleeding again in premenopausal condition. So anovular bleeding can be seen in adolescent girls or also in premenopausal women. And here the bleeding will be excessive, and the duration will also more, and it is prolonged also. Irregular hota hai, excessive hota hai, and also prolonged hota hai anovular bleeding condition mein. So again, all this is due to unopposed secretion of the estrogen on the endometrium. So and estrogen jo bhi hormone release hota hai wo endometrium ke upar responsible ya it function the function or shedding or ripening of the endometrium all due to secretion of estrogen, all depends on estrogen. So whenever this insufficient or improper production of estrogen, it leads to unopposed secretion on the endometrium, then it leads to anovular bleeding. And how can we diagnose such conditions? So if a woman comes with the complaints of any heavy bleeding or irregular menstrual bleeding, then we have to take detailed complete history regarding age of the patient, because as I said, age is very important, considering if she is in an adolescent period, if she is in a reproductive age, or she is in a premenopausal or menopausal age. So age of the patient is very important. And then regarding parity and regarding regularity, that is conditions in menstrual history, that is amount, duration and regularity, all those things. And also contraceptive history and obstetrical history we have to take. And then we have to check for general examination. While doing general examination, we have to check for pallorness and swelling in the thyroid gland, because thyroid abnormalities is one of the metabolic condition which can lead to or which can alter the HPO axis. So any swelling in the thyroid gland we have to check. And also we have to go for swelling in the legs, all those things, to check any severe anemic conditions. And we have to go for per abdominal examination to elicit any tenderness, or any per vaginal examination to elicit any infection, fibroids or polyp growths in the genital region. And next we have to go for some laboratory investigations, like estimation of hemoglobin, and to check the platelet counts. And also we have to check for coagulation profile, that is BTCT and PTT, that is partial prothrombin time, to check any coagulation disorders will be there. And next we have to go for thyroid function test also, to rule out any thyroid abnormalities. And we have to do normal ultrasonography of abdomen and pelvis to rule out any organic pathology, that means to exclude any organic pathology, because abnormal vaginal menstrual bleeding or abnormal uterine bleeding may also due to because of fibroid ke wajah se ho sakta hai, polyps ke wajah se ho sakta hai, ya बिकॉज ऑफ इंसर्शन ऑफ कॉपर टी के वजह से भी हो सकता है. सो वी हैव टू एंड ड्यू टू अबनॉर्मल प्रेगनेंसी के वजह से भी हो सकता है. सो वी हैव टू एक्सक्लूड ऑल दोज कंडीशंस एंड वी हैव टू कन्फर्म इज दिस बिकॉज प्योरली बिकॉज ऑफ ऑल्टर्ड एच पी ओ एक्सिस और इट इज़ प्योरली डी यू बी और इट इज़ मे बी ड्यू टू सम अदर कंडीशन. सो वी हैव टू एक्सक्लूड ऑल दोज पॉइंट्स वी हैव टू गो फॉर अल्ट्रासोनोग्राफी. And after confirming the disease, that is after doing diagnosis, we have to go for management, how to treat these patients. As a general measures, first of all, we have to advise the patient for weight reduction, and also we have to prescribe some iron supplements and folic acid supplements to overcome anemia. And as a medical management, first we have to to stop the bleeding. First, the main intention is in excessive vaginal bleeding, we have to stop the bleeding. For as a hemostatic, first we have to we'll start with non-hormonal drugs like tranexamic acid, 1 to 2 grams of tranexamic acid, because it acts as an anti-fibrinolytic activity. And we can also prescribe ethambutolate, that is 500 mg of ethambutolate QID in QID dose, and it maintains the integrity in the capillaries. So we will prescribe ethambutolate. And if it fails, if these non-hormonal drugs will fail, then we have to go for we have to prescribe some hormonal drugs. That is progestins. Progestins are synthetic progesterones in the form of norethosterone or medroxyprogesterone, and we can also prescribe the combination of both estrogen and progesterone. That means from 5th to 25th day of the cycle, that is starting with the 5th day of the cycle, and we have to continue both estrogen and progesterone up to 25th day of the cycle, and then this will be continued for another 3 cycles. This schedule should be continued for another 3 cycles, so that in that time this endogenous hormone will maintains the intact the normal function of the HPO axis. Then if all these hormonal or non-hormonal treatment fails, then we should go for surgical management. In that, first we have to go with uterine curettage, that is a DNC, that is uterine curettage. That means scraping of the endometrium. So if we do this kind of minor surgery, it is a minor surgery only, the uterine curettage. While performing this, it acts as a hemostatic because it will scrape all the unhealthy and necrosed endometrium. So it acts as a hemostatic. Then it will reduces the bleeding. If still it is the woman is not responsible for this, then we have to go with endometrial ablation. Endometrial ablation is a surgical procedure where we will destroy the endometrium line through laser vaporization, or further we can go for abdominal hysterectomy. That means removal of uterus through abdominally. But the last two surgical procedures what I have explained, that is endometrial ablation and hysterectomy, this kind of surgical procedure only we can advise patient if the age of the patient is more than 40 years, and if the family is completed, then only we can advise these kind of surgeries. So otherwise we have to treat the patient symptomatically, or we should treat the patient. So thus it completes all Pittaja Univyapath conditions under this Univyapath Prakarana. In next further classes, we'll discuss about some Kaphaja Univyapath conditions like Kaphaja Univyapath, Karanini and Upaplita Univyapath in next session. So until, if anyone has got doubts regarding these topics, or practically if you you're facing any problems while seeing the patients, you can leave comments on the comment box. And I would like to thank all the organizers of Tadvitiya Sambhasha Parishad so to give or to provide such opportunity. Thank you. Take care.